إن الحمد لله نحمده ونستعينه ونستغفره ونعوذ بالله من شرور أنفسنا وسيئات أعمالنا من يهده الله فلا مضل له ومن يضلل فلا هادي له وأشهد أن لا إله إلا الله وحده لا شريك له وأشهد أن محمدا عبده ورسوله صلى الله عليه وعلى آله وصحبه وسلم تسليما مزيدا أما بعد إخوتي في الله we thank Allah Jalla wa Ala for this blessing which He has given us. فوالله ثم والله إن الصدر لا ينشرح برؤية أمثال هذه الوجوه المستنيرة. By Allah, indeed, the chest becomes relaxed at seeing the likes of these faces. People of the Sunnah, في زمن الغربة, in a time period where they are considered to be strange. You, the way you look, your ibadat, your mu'taqadat, all of these matters are strange to the people, even those who are Muslims. For indeed, Ahlul Bid'ah, في جميع أشكالهم وأنواعهم وأصنافهم, يوجهون سهام الطعن في أهل السنة والجماعة. For indeed, the people of innovation, in their different sects and factions, all of them, they point the arrows of criticism against Ahl Sunnah wal Jama'ah. So seeing the likes of this group, it brings happiness to the believer, a time to benefit without a doubt from the teachings of the Quran and the Sunnah upon the understanding of the Salaf al-Salih. This is what has brought us, and we thank Allah Azza wa Jal for this. And ikhwani fillah, before going into the topic which we wish to discuss, we wanted to remind our brothers of the hadith of our Messenger sallallahu alayhi wasallam in Muslim, from the hadith of our mother Aisha radiallahu anha, that she said about him sallallahu alayhi wasallam, كان عمله ديمة, that his actions were persistent. Our Messenger alayhi salatu wasalam, when he did an action of worship, he would be consistent in this. So the likes of these gatherings, and when we see our brothers and when the sisters also meet, you find that sometimes we become mashghul, preoccupied from the dhikr, the remembrance after the salawat. And in these kind of scenarios, when a person is incapable of completing the dhikr, and the best of manners and the most dhikr, 33 times for the tasbih and the tahmid and the tahleel, then it is also affirmed from our Messenger alayhi salatu wasalam, from the hadith of Abdullah ibn Amr, which is in the Sunan of Abi Dawud, to do it 10 times. 10 times the tasbih, 10 times the tahmid and the takbir. So you're saying subhanallah 10, alhamdulillah 10, and Allahu Akbar 10. Wa ma ashala, and how easy this is. So ikhwani fillah, let our actions be actions of deema, where we're consistent in the obedience of Allah Azza wa Jal. Even in these scenarios where sometimes we become busied from this by the likes of the khair, then from thanking the blessing of Allah Azza wa Jal is to be consistent upon the khair. Likewise, we remind ourselves firstly that we do not forget the sunnah after Isha. The sunnah which many of us have not prayed, then do not forget to pray. Whether this is after the lectures or whether you return back to your house, then continue the khair. And this is what will keep you firm bi-idhnillahi azza wa jal, as being consistent upon the ta'at huwa min asbab al-thabat. It is from the reasons of being firm upon the way of Allah Jalla wa Ala. And ikhwani fi Allah, we are thankful as well, as we have seen some of our ikhwa al-ahibba that we have not seen in some time. The brothers who have come from East and the brothers who have come from all of the different directions who have come to visit, who have come to benefit. ونخصهم بالذكر, and we specify them in mention, لما نعلم فيهم من الخير والثبات والعلم, and we mention them specifically due to what we know from them, from firmness and knowledge. أخونا أبو إسحاق, the brother Haider Abbas, and those who have come with them from the Ikhwah from the East, may Allah Azza wa Jal preserve them and keep them firm, and to give them tawfiq in continuing the tadrees and nafi' the beneficial teachings that they started. فَمَرْحَبًا بِهِمْ إِخْوَانِ فِي اللَّهِ. As the title of the conference, it reached all of us, inshallah ta'ala, which was the trial of knowledge. And without a doubt, there is a trial in the ilm. There is al-bala. There is a test which comes with this ilm. And it is not something which is easily obtained. And for this reason, we wanted to mention how the scholars, the ulama, how their steps were in seeking knowledge, and how much effort they gave in obtaining this ilm. For when a person, he hears what they were upon, and he reflects over their lives, you find in this humility for yourself. And as I was telling some of the brothers the other day, that when you look at their lives and what they're upon from hirsa lil ilm, how hard they strived in obtaining knowledge and how they gave their lives to the ilm, you will say, I'm not doing anything with my life. You will say, I'm not even a student yet. And this tadhkir, this reminder and what they were upon, it gives us as believers in Allah Azza wa Jal and His meeting in the last day, it gives us encouragement to strive further. As however you may try and how much good you may be doing, there's always room for more. For this reason, Allah Azza wa Jal, He says, كَلَّا لَمَّا يَقْضِ مَا أَمَرَ. Nay and no, He has not yet fulfilled what we have commanded Him to do. So the believer is always mutawadi', he's always humble, seeing the naqs, the deficiency, and the taqseer and the shortcoming in his life and in the ilm and that which surrounds him. And for this reason, the dhikra, the reminder, it benefits. As Allah Azza wa Jal, He said, وَذَكِّرْ فَإِنَّ الذِّكْرَ تَنْفَعُ الْمُؤْمِنِينَ. And remind, for indeed the reminder benefits the believer. So it is they who benefit from the likes of these reminders. And this mawdu', this subject, which is the eagerness of the ulama in seeking ilm, this subject, it came to mind for many reasons. From the greatest of these reasons is that which is found in the hadith of our Messenger sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, reported by Ahmed in his Musnad. And it is a sound hadith when he said alayhi salatu wa salam, لكل عمل شرة وفترة. Every action, it has a time period where the person is eager and he's striving in it. And it has in it a fatra, a time when the person, he finds in himself weakness in that aspect or that regard. All actions, they are like this. And if you look at your life as a believer, you will see this. The times when you used to strive in fasting, whether this is the Monday and the Thursday, or these are the Ayyam al-Bid, what they refer to, the three times a month, or this is in the night prayer, or this is a portion of the Quran which you used to recite, you will find in yourself that there were times that you had in yourself this shirra, this spark, and this eagerness, and you were consistent. And then you find there were times where you had a fatra, where you became weak from it. So the Messenger alayhi salatu wasalam, he tells us in this hadith that actions are like this. Then he tells us, فَمَنْ كَانَتْ فَتْرَتُهُ إِلَى سُنَّتِي فَقَدْ نَجَى. The one who's his weak time, or at the time when he's declining, if he's going towards my sunnah, then he is one who is safe. وَإِنْ كَانَ إِلَى غَيْرِ ذَلِكَ فَقَدْ هَلَكَ. And if it's towards other than this, other than his sunnah, then the person is destroyed. So this is a tanbih and a notice for us that in any situation you're in, more specifically in the likes of this country that we're in, where the shahawat and the maladdat, the things that the nar is surrounded by, they're easily obtained. Very easy for a person to do things that will enter him into the hellfire. As it is open and there's nothing preventing you, illa your fear of Allah Jalla wa Ala and His muraqabah, that you are aware that He's watching over you. So the one whose fatrah, his weak time, is towards the sunnah of the Messenger sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, then he is one who is safe. He is one who has obtained goodness for himself. So this was from the reasons which led to this. And from the reasons which also led to this is what we see from al-inshighal bi ghayri al-ilm. People busying themselves with other than knowledge. This time period where the phones and the laptops and the tablets and all of these different devices and gadgets, they're available. So you find the person chatting away from the night to the early hours of the morning, wasting his time with that which does not bring back to him benefit. Rather, it may even be something which is harmful for him in his akhirah. So this is from the things that causes us to remind ourselves as to how the ulama used to spend their time and what they used to do with their lives and how eager they were in this ilm. And from these aspects as well, which leads us to this topic of importance, is to know, ikhwani fillah, that the a'mal that we do, these deeds that we are doing, they are a benefit for us when we die upon that khair. If a person is doing khair throughout his life, and towards the end of his life, he's overtaken by sin, by deviation, then the Messenger alayhi salatu wasalam, he has told us from the hadith of Sahal ibn Sa'd in Bukhari, إِنَّمَا الْأَعْمَالِ بِالْخَوَاتِينَ, that indeed the actions, they are by that which they end upon. So if your actions throughout your life was طلب العلم, and you were consistent upon this until the yaqeen of death came to you, then يُرْجَى لِهَذَا الْعَبْدِ الْفَلَاحِ, this person, it is hoped for him success. Success which he achieved in the dunya, and also بَيْنَ يَدَيْ اللَّهِ, when he meets Allah Azza wa Jal. So these are different matters which called us to this. In addition to what we take as a benefit from the speech of Imam An-Nawawi rahimahullah, when he said in the Muqaddimah, the foreword to his book, Al-Majmu' Sharh Al-Muhadhab, which is from the books of the Shafi'iyya and Fiqh, he mentions in the foreword to his book, وَالْحَاسِلْ أَنَّهُمْ مُتَّفِقُونَ عَلَىٰ أَنَّ الْإِشْتِغَالَ بِالْعِلْمِ أفضل من الاشتغال بالنوافل الصوم والصلاة والتسبيح ونحو ذلك. He says, and the summary of this is that the scholars have agreed that being busy with knowledge, it is better than busying yourself with nawafil as-sawm, that which is from voluntary actions of fasting, voluntary prayer, voluntary tasbih, subhanallah, alhamdulillah, and the dhikr, and so on. To busy yourself with knowledge, Imam An-Nawawi rahimahullah is mentioning that the scholars have agreed is better than this. So all of these actions, all of that we have mentioned, they show us the importance of the ilm and how the scholars used to strive in this. And the scholars, their wasaya, their admonitions and their advices with this regard, there were many. And their lives revolved around knowledge. From the time the person is awake to the time he rests, if he can fully rest the night, if he can rest the night, we say, as it will come to us how eager they were in the ilm. And this is because the Messenger sallallahu alaihi wasallam, he said, man human la yashba'an, as it comes in the hadith of Ibn Mas'ud, reported by Darimi and others. Two eager people, they never become satisfied. Man humun fil ilm, one who is eager in obtaining knowledge, وَمَنْ هُمٌ فِي الدُّنْيَا, and the one who is eager in obtaining the dunya. You find these two people restless, and this is a reality. Look at the tujar today, the businessmen, and those who have made for themselves and accumulated large amounts of wealth. You find them that they were people who were very diligent in the dunya. They sleep little, they wake up early, they don't have time to talk. What has engulfed their hearts and swallowed their hearts is their hirs, their eagerness in obtaining the dunya. And likewise, you find from the scholars, those whose hearts were engulfed with ilm and they were overtaken by their hirs, eagerness in obtaining knowledge, till they did not care about anything else. Ibn al-Qayyim rahimahullah, he mentions in Miftah Dar al-Sa'ada, as a commentary to the previous hadith, فجعل النبي صلى الله عليه وسلم النهم في العلم وعدم الشبع منه من لوازم الإيمان وأوصاف المؤمنين. He said, رحمه الله, that the Messenger صلى الله عليه وسلم, he has made the eagerness in obtaining knowledge and not becoming full from it from that which iman necessitates. From the necessities of iman is that the person doesn't become full from knowledge. And likewise, he has mentioned it to be from the awsaf, the attributes of the believer. And this is an important note for us. So that person, even if he has gone out to seek knowledge, he has memorized what he has memorized, he does not become satisfied from the ilm. Because this is from the subul, the pathways of the shaitan to distance that person from the knowledge. That he makes it seem to you that, I've done this, let me do something else. And by this, يَكُونُ مُسْتَبْدِلًا لِلَّذِي هُوَ أَدْنَى بِالَّذِي هُوَ خَيْرٌ. He will be interchanging that which is of least value for that which is of the greatest of value. So the person, his life should be around it. And not to look at yourself as, been there, done that. As the shaitan, he uses this in distancing the person from khayr. And Ibn Qayyim rahimahullah, he goes on to mention several examples from the people of knowledge. And how they used to give their life to it. He quotes from Abdullah ibn Mubarak radiyallahu anhu wa rahimah. Some of the people criticized against him his diligence in knowledge. And they said to him, إِلَى مَتَى, how long will you continue like this, O Ibn Mubarak? قَالَ إِلَى الْمَمَاتِ, he said, until I die. Short words. This is a lifetime matter. It is not a matter where it is a model, where the person is seeking knowledge because his friend sought knowledge. And now they're not seeking knowledge, so he stops seeking knowledge. This is a lifetime objective. This seeking of ilm, it is from the time that you realize its importance up until you meet Allah Azza wa Jal. Look at this scholar, and he's saying that he will continue with the ilm until he dies. And he is not the only one that Ibn Qayyim rahimahullah mentions. Al-Imam Ahmed, likewise similar is reported from him. In another narration reported by Ibn al-Jawzi, that he was seen with the mihbara, which is the inkwell. A man seen Imam Ahmed carrying the inkwell. So he said to him, Ya Aba Abdullah, Anta qad balagta hadha al-mablagh. O father of Abdullah, you have reached this level. Wa anta imam al-muslimin, and you are the leader of the Muslims. وَمَعَكَ الْمِحْبَرَ تَحْمِلُهَا, and you are carrying the inkwell. Then he said, رَحِمُهُ اللَّهُ مَعَ الْمِحْبَرَةِ إِلَى الْمَقْبَرَةِ, I will be with the inkwell until I enter the grave. This shows how they saw the importance of this ilm. And they would be continuous with it until they met Allah Azza wa Jal. And many of them, from those who have passed and those who have come after, were like this. Ibn al-Jawzi, Abu al-Faraj, not Ibn al-Qayyim. There's a difference between the two. If you say Ibn al-Jawzi, he's Abu al-Faraj. The author, he had many books which he wrote, who also was from the Hanbali Madhab. He had with him mistakes, like many of the scholars, rahimahullah. But he had with him much knowledge which he left behind, and the people of knowledge up until today, they quote him. He said a statement of wisdom in his book, Sayyidul Khatir. He said, تَأَمَّلْتُ عَجَبًا, I paid attention in amazement, I contemplated. وَهُوَ أَنَّ كُلَّ شَيْءٍ نَفِيسٍ خَطِيرٍ يَطُولُ طَرِيقُهُ. Every single thing which is precious, which is of value, he says, يَطُولُ طَرِيقُهُ, it has a long path to get to it. يَكْثُرُ التَّعَبُ فِي تَحْسِيلِهِ, people become tired in obtaining it. فَإِنَّ الْعِلْمِ لَمَّا كَانَ أَشْرَفَ الْأَشْيَاءِ, and when knowledge, it was the most noble of things. لَمْ يُحْسَلْ إِلَّا بِتَعْبْ وَالسَّهَرْ وَالتَّكْرَارِ, it was not obtained except with difficulty, with sahar, sleepless nights, with repetition. وَحَجْرَ اللَّذَّاتِ وَالرَّاحَ, and leaving off the ladhat, the things which are sweet to your soul. Leaving them off. This is how they obtain the ilm, he's telling us. And the first and foremost, from the leaders of this ummah of the Messenger sallallahu alayhi wasallam, and those who have been commanded to follow their way, were the Sahaba radiallahu anhum. They were the most eager and most diligent and hardworking of people in obtaining ilm. Abu Huraira radiallahu anhu, He reports to us a hadith which is in the Sahihain, showing his eagerness in knowledge. When he said, radiallahu anhu, وَإِنَّ إِخْوَتِي مِنَ الْمُهَاجِرِينَ كَانَ يَشْغَلُهُمْ صَفْقٌ بِالْأَسْوَاقِ. My brothers from the Muhajirin, they were busied in the marketplaces in doing transactions, buying and selling. They were businessmen. He says, وَكُنْتُ أَلْزَمُ رَسُولَ اللَّهِ صَلَى اللَّهُ عَلَيْهِ وَسَلَّمُ. And I used to be continuous and bind myself with the Messenger sallallahu alayhi wasallam. And in the narration of Muslim, وَكُنْتُ أَخْدَمُ. I used to service the Messenger sallallahu alayhi wasallam ala mil'i batni, with that which would fill my stomach. Some of the people of knowledge have explained that he would remain servicing the Messenger sallallahu alayhi wasallam and receive just something to fill his stomach, something little. As he's showing us that the Sahaba from the Muhajirun, they were busy in doing their transactions, which is permissible. There's nothing which prevents a person from buying and selling and obtaining the rizq of Allah Azza wa Jalla in a halal manner. And likewise, the Ansar, they were busy. He says, وَكَانَ يَشْغَلُ إِخْوَتِي مِنَ الْأَنصَارِ عَمَلُ أَمْوَالِهِمْ. And my brothers from the Ansar, they were busy by taking care of their amwal, their wealth. And what is intended, obviously, is the livestock, the farms, plantations. This is all from wealth. So Abu Hurairah radiallahu anhu, he tells us that he was a maskeen. كنت مسكينا من مساكين أهل الصفة. He was from the masakin of the people of Suffa. And the people of Suffa, they were those who were poor, who made hijrah to the Messenger sallallahu alayhi wasallam. So Abu Hurairah, he was from them. And he would bind himself to the Messenger in this state, continuously taking a hadith from him, until he became the hafidh, the sahabi who narrated the most hadith from the Messenger sallallahu alayhi wasallam. Ala al-itlaq, there was no one like Abu Hurairah in the reporting of a hadith. Thousands of a hadith he reported from our Messenger sallallahu alayhi wasallam. Even with him being from those who accepted Islam later on, as he was not from the first and foremost to accept Islam, but he accepted Islam later on. And with this, he became the sahabi who reported the most hadith. Imam al-Bukhari, rahimahullah, he also chapters showing us how they were eager, the sahaba, in seeking knowledge. A chapter in his sahih when he said, Bab al-tanawub fil-ilm, the chapter of exchanging one another in knowledge. At-tanawub fil-ilm, meaning that you seek knowledge and you have a companion who also seeks with you. So one of you comes to the halaqah and he benefits and he returns back to you with the knowledge and you come and replace him. And this was a da'b, the way of Umar radiallahu anhu ibn al-Khattab. The hadith is in the Sahih of al-Bukhari, as we mentioned, where he says, كنت أنا وجار لي من الأنصار في بني أمية ابن زيد. He said, me and a companion of mine from the Ansar, who was from this tribe of Umayyah ibn Zayd. And they were the people who lived fi Awali al-Madinah, the upper part of Medina. They were not close to the masjid of the Messenger sallallahu alayhi wa sallam and his halaqat. So Umar radiallahu anhu, he says, وَكُنَّا نَتَنَاوَبْ أَنُّزُّولَ عَلَى رَسُولِ اللَّهِ صَلَى اللَّهُ عَلَيْهِ وَسَلَّمْ يَنْزِلُ يَوْمًا وَأَنْزِلُ يَوْمًا. He said, we used to interchange one another in visiting the Messenger sallallahu alayhi wasallam in his gatherings. He would sit one day and I would sit one day, and they would interchange like this. He says, فَإِذَا نَزَلْتُهُ جِئْتُهُ بِخَبَرِ ذَلِكَ الْيَوْمِ مِنَ الْوَحِي وَغَيْرِهِ. If I would go down, I would bring the report, the news of the wahi, to him. And likewise, he would do the same. So this is how they were, radiallahu anhum ajma'in. And this is a reminder for us following their way, that if you're incapable of coming to the dars, coming to the halaqah, then ask about it. Ask those who will attend. Ask those from the people who you know who have benefited the fawaid. And in this time where many things are taped and musajjal, they're recorded, it is very easy, even if you're incapable of attending the halaqat of ilm, to easily obtain the knowledge. And this sahabi, Umar radiallahu anhu, who we know his level in Islam, he is striving to this extent in knowledge. فَأَيْنَ نَحْنُ مِنْ ذَلِكَ. Where are we then from this? Abu Hurairah radiallahu anhu, we've mentioned him in the past, how eager he was in seeking knowledge. And the hadith, another hadith reported by Bukhari, when the Messenger sallallahu alayhi wasallam, Abu Hurairah, said to him, قِلَ يَا رَسُولُ اللَّهِ مَنْ أَسْعَدُ النَّاسِ بِشَفَاعَتِكَ. O Messenger of Allah, who is the most deserving of your shafa'ah, of your intercession on the Day of Judgment? Because Ahlul Sunnah wal Jama'ah, they affirm the shafa'ah li Ahl al-Kaba'ir min Ummati Nabi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. For the people who have committed major sins and did not repent, and they meet Allah Azza wa Jal with this, if they are cast into the hellfire, wa'iyadhan billah, then we affirm the shafa'ah. And we affirm the other shafa'at which are there as well on the Day of Judgment. And the Messenger, he said to Abu Huraira radiallahu anhu at that point, لَقَدْ ذَنَنْتُ يَا أَبَا هُرَيْرَ أَنْ لَا يَسْأَلُنِي عَنْ هَذَا الْحَدِيثِ أَحَدٌ أَوَّلُ مِنْكَ. I knew, O Abu Huraira, that no one would ask me of this before you. Why is this? He says, لِمَا رَأَيْتُ مِنْ حِرْسِكَ عَلَى الْحَدِيثِ. Because of what I have seen from you, O Abu Huraira, in your eagerness in seeking knowledge. So the Messenger alayhi salatu wasalam, he knew that Abu Huraira would be the first to ask him this question because of what he's seen from him in his hirs, his eagerness in obtaining knowledge. And he also benefited from this, that the muallim, the one who is a teacher, he is one who understands his students very well. He knows the one who is more eager in obtaining the ilm, the one who is hardworking, the one who is striving in this regard. Ibn Mas'ud radiallahu anhu, he shows us his eagerness in knowledge and how he was ready to travel distances to obtain this ilm. Al-Bukhari again reports from him radiallahu anhu that he said, Wallahi alladhi la ilaha ghayruh, by Allah, the one who there is nothing worthy of worship but him, ma unzilat suratun min kitabillahi illa ana a'lamu ayna unzilat. There is not an ayah in the book of, there's not a surah, a chapter in the book of Allah, except that I know where it was revealed. وَلَا أُنزِلَتْ آيَةٌ مِنْ كِتَابِ اللَّهِ. Not an ayah was also revealed from the book of Allah. إِلَّا أَنَا أَعْلَمُ فِي مَا أُنزِلَتْ. Except that I know the reason why it was revealed. He knows where it was revealed. The whole Quran, subhanAllah. If you are just to contemplate over this, the whole Quran, he's telling you, there's not a surah except I know where it was revealed, and there's not an ayah except that I know the reason it was revealed. وَلَوْ أَعْلَمُ أَحَدًا أَعْلَمُ مِنِّي بِكِتَابِ اللَّهِ تَبْلَغُهُ الْإِبْلِ لَرَكِبْتُ إِلَيْهِ. And if I knew a person who was more knowledgeable about me in the book of Allah, and the camels were capable of reaching him, I would go to him. Humility in seeking knowledge. This is how they were. And prepared to take on the difficulties in obtaining of the ilm. Sometimes we look at ourselves, it is cold. Without a doubt, it is cold. But look at this Sahabi in the hot sun. He doesn't have a vehicle like we have. There's no planes. He is willing to take upon himself a journey. As long as his camel would reach it, he is ready to go. All for the purpose of ilm. This shows us how they were and how much they love the ilm, which Allah Azza wa Jal, he has revealed in the Quran and the Sunnah. And they continue like this, even after the death of the Messenger sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. Ibn Abbas radiallahu anhu, it is reported by Darimi in his Sunan with a sahih chain, authentic chain of narration, where Ibn Abbas, he says radiallahu anhu, لَمَّا تُوفِيَ رَسُولُ اللَّهِ صَلَى اللَّهُ عَلَيْهِ وَسَلَّمْ قُلْتُ لِرَجُلٍ مِنَ الْأَنصَارِ يَا فُلَانْ هَلُمَّ فَلْنَسْأَلْ أَصْحَابِ النَّبِيِّ صَلَى اللَّهُ عَلَيْهِ وَسَلَّمْ فَإِنَّهُمْ الْيَوْمْ كَثِيرٌ. Ibn Abbas, he said, when the Messenger صلى الله عليه وسلم, he passed away, I said to a companion of mine from the Ansar, get up, let us go to the companions of the Messenger sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, for indeed today there are many in number. Get up, let's go and seek knowledge. فَقَالَ وَعَجَبًا لَكَ يَا إِبْنَ Abbas. His companion from the Ansar said, how amazing you are, O Ibn Abbas. أَتَرَى النَّاسَ يَحْتَاجُونَ إِلَيْكَ. Do you think the people are in need of you? وَفِي النَّاسِ مِنْ أَصْحَابِ نَبِيِّ صَلَى اللَّهُ عَلَيْهِ وَسَلَّمَ مَنْ تَرَى. And among the people are the companions of the Messenger sallallahu alayhi wa sallam who you see. Do you think the people are in need of you? Ibn Abbas is telling him. He says, فَتَرَكَ ذَلِكَ. And he left this companion from the Ansar, he left it. And Ibn Abbas radiallahu anhu, he says, وَأَقْبَلْتُ عَلَى الْمَسْأَلَةِ. I began asking. And what is intended here is the asking for knowledge. He began to seek and inquire, gaining and obtaining knowledge. He says, فَإِنْ كَانَ لَيَبْلُغُنِي الْحَدِيثُ عَنِ الرَّجُلِ فَآتِيهِ وَهُوَ قَائِلٌ. He said, a hadith would reach me from such and such a person. وَهُوَ قَائِلٌ. And what is intended by قَائِل, he's in the time of قَيْلُولَة. He was taking his forenoon nap. So he would come to this man, as he has heard, he has with him narrations, and he wants to take these narrations. And he realizes that the person is sleeping. He says, فَأَتَوَسَّدُ رِدَاءِ عَلَى بَابِهِ. I take my rida, which is the upper body garment, and I turn it into a pillow. And he sits there, Ibn Abbas impatient. He says, فَتَسْفِ الرِّيحُ عَلَى وَجْهِ التُرَابِ. The wind begins to strike my face with the dust and the dirt. This is a Sahabi Jalil, the cousin of the Messenger sallallahu alaihi wasallam. This person who we know his status in Islam, and from his humility in seeking knowledge and humbling himself, he is sitting there, the wind is throwing dust in his face and he's not disturbed. He says, فَيَخْرُجْ فَيَرَانِي. The person would come out and he would see me. فَيَقُولِ يَا ابْنَ عَمِّ رَسُولِ اللَّهِ صَلَى اللَّهُ عَلَيْهِ وَسَلَّمْ مَا جَاءَ بِكْ. O cousin of the Messenger of Allah sallallahu alayhi wasallam, what has brought you? He says, أَلَا أَرْسَلْتَ إِلَيَّ. Why did you not send someone to me فَآتِيك, so I would come to you? Again, the humility of the Sahaba. They realized the status of Ibn Abbas, and they felt disturbed that Ibn Abbas would sit there in front of their house, and he could have easily sent someone to them and they would go. He says, فَأَقُولُ لَا أَنَا أَحَقُّ أَنْ آتِيك. Ibn Abbas says, no, I am more deserving to come to you to seek this ilm. He says, فَأَسْأَلُهُ عَنِ الْحَدِيثِ. And I would ask him about the narration. He says, فَبَقِيَ الرَّجُلُ حَتَّى رَآنِي. The man, he remained until he's seen me. And he's intending his companion from the Ansar. He's seen me later on. وَقَدْ اجْتَمَعَ النَّاسِ عَلَيَّ. And the people had gathered around me. He says, قَالَ كَانَ هَذَا الْفَتَى أَعَقَلْ مِنِّي. He says, this young man, he was more understanding than me. And Ibn Abbas, radiallahu anhu, it is reported by Shaykh al-Islam, who quotes from Ibn Jarir, that Ibn Mas'ud said about him, نِعْمَ تُرْجُمَانَ الْقُرْآنِ. Ibn Abbas, how good of an explainer of the Qur'an he is, Ibn Abbas. And the isnad, it is authentic, as he says. As he lived after Ibn Mas'ud for many years, 32 years, in the correct opinion, Ibn Abbas, he lived on after Ibn Mas'ud. Rather, Abdullah Ibn Abbas, he lived on 36 years after that. Then Ibn Taymiyyah rahmatullahi alayhi says, فَمَا ظَنُّكَ بِمَا كَسَبَهُ مِنَ الْعُلُومِ بَعْدَ Ibn Mas'ud. What do you perceive he obtained from knowledge after Ibn Mas'ud? This Sahabi al-Jalil, we take many, if a person was just to sit down and explain this hadith alone, you would take away fawaid mithl durar, benefits the likes of gems. The Sahabi, his status in Islam, his humility in seeking knowledge, his bearing the difficulty, the wind blowing dirt in his face, his patience in this, and what Allah Azza wa Jal gave him afterward, that the people gathered around him. And that Sahabi, he said, this man, he was more intelligent than me. And these are the people who Allah Azza wa Jal, he loved them, the Sahaba radiallahu anhum, as they were people of khair, and Allah Azza wa Jal, he was pleased with them, radiallahu anhum wa radu an. Allah, he is pleased with them and they are pleased with him. And there are many narrations from our Salaf, may Allah be pleased with them all, and how they used to give themselves to this knowledge, taking from their teachers, from the Sahaba, and implementing it in their lives and striving. And some have said qadiman, in the past it was said, إِنَّ الْعِلْمِ إِذَا أَعْطَيْتَهُ كُلَّكْ أَعْطَاكَ بَعْضَهُ. Knowledge, if you give yourself entirely to it, it will give you some of it. وَإِنْ أَعْطَيْتَهُ بَعْضَكْ لَمْ يُعْطِكَ شَيْئًا. And if you give some of yourself to knowledge, it will not give you anything. And this is how they live their lives, giving themselves entirely to it. Sufyan ibn Uyayna, it is reported in the Jami' of Khatib, that he mentions, كان الشاب إذا وقع في الحديث احتسبه أهله. A young man, if he fell into seeking narrations, his family, they would seek their reward with Allah for him. Meaning it was as if this person is gone, they're never going to see him again. They would say, may Allah reward us for that person. This is how they were. Ibn Aqil al-Hanbali, who was also from the scholars we've mentioned, we've took in the past his book in Adab, in the Makarim al-Akhlaq. He has a narration which shows you how he used to strive in ilm. He says, إِنِّي لَا يَحِلُّ لِي أَنْ أُضَيَّ سَاعَةً مِنْ عُمْرِي. It is not permissible for me to waste 1 hour of my life. Is not permissible. He says, حَتَّى إِذَا تَعَطَّلَ لِسَانِي عَنْ مُذَاكَرَةٍ وَمُنَاظَرَةٍ وَبَصَرِي عَنْ مُطَالَعَةٍ. Even if my tongue is incapable of revising and debating, and my eyes are incapable of reading and reviewing, he says, أَعْمَلْتُ فِكْرِي. I begin to think and ponder and reflect. فِي حَالَةِ رَاحَتِي وَأَنَا مُسْتَطْرِحْ. He said, in the time while I'm relaxed and I am laying down. He says, فَلَا أَنْهَذْ إِلَّا وَقَدْ خَطَرَ لِي مَا أَسْطُرُهُ. And I will not stand up except I have something to write down. So even in the time he's sick, he's incapable of reading, he's incapable of writing, he's incapable of debating, he's lying down, he's thinking of masail. He's doing tahdhib within himself, preparing them. And when he gets up, he has something to write. Look at how they used to strive for ilm, the scholars. We take also another narration from Abdurrahman, the son of Abu Hatim, Al-Razi, the Imam, the Hafiz, Rahmatullah alayhi. He says, Kunna bi Misr. We were in Misr, 7 ashhur, 7 months, they were in Egypt. Lam na'kul fiha maraqa. We did not drink even soup. They're incapable of drinking soup. He says, كُلُّ نَهَارُنَا مُقَسَّمٌ لِمَجَالِسِ الشُّيُوخِ. Our whole day, daylight hours, it is split between the majalis, sitting with the scholars. That's their day. وَبِاللَّيْلَ النَّسْخُ وَالْمُقَابَلَةِ. And in the night, they are copying what they have taken and they're reviewing to make sure their wording, the manner they have wrote, is correct. The whole day and their night is like this. قَالَ فَأَتَيْنَا يَوْمًا أَنَا وَرَفِيقٌ لِي شَيْخًا فَقَالُهُ عَلِيلٌ. He said, me and a companion of mine, one day we went to one of our shuyukh, which we heard, or who we heard he was sick. He says, فَرَأَيْنَا فِي تَرِيقِنَا السَّمَكَةَ أَعْجَبَتْنَا. We seen in our path to visit him while he was sick, a fish, which it seemed tempting to us. They wanted to eat it, they desired it. فَاشْتَرَيْنَاهَا. We bought it, he says. فَلَمَّا سِرْنَا إِلَى الْبَيْتِ حَضَرَ وَقْتُ الْمَجْلِسِ. He said, when we got to the house, the time for the dars had begun. فَلَمْ يُمْكِنَّا إِصْلَاحُ. It was not capable for us to prepare that fish. فَمَذَيْنَا إِلَى الْمَجْلِسِ. We left to the gathering. He says, فَلَمْ نَزِلْ حَتَّى أَتَى عَلَيْهِ ثَلَاثَةُ أَيَّامِ. We continued like this until 3 days had passed. وَكَادَ أَنْ يَتَغَيَّرْ. And it began to change. It was starting to rot, the fish. He says, فَأَكَلْنَاهُ نَيًّا. We ate it when it was raw. This is how they were, subhanAllah. Something that maybe we take for granted, we cast away. The fish was almost rotting. 3 days, they're incapable of cooking this fish. And they ate it when it was raw. He says, لَمْ يَكُنْ لَنَا فَرَاغٌ أَنْ نُعْطِيَهُ مَنْ يَشْوِيهِ. We didn't have any capability of giving even a person to prepare it for us. Forget themselves. They couldn't even find time to give it to someone and say, cook this fish for us. They had to eat it when it was raw. يحيى بن سعيد القطان رحمه الله, also Al-Khatib mentions in the Jami' that he said about himself, كنت أخرج من البيت قبل الغداء فلا أرجع إلا العتمة. I would leave in the early morning hours and I would not come back until Isha. This was their cycle in knowledge. So a person, he takes from this, if you come to the halaqa 1 day, 2 days, when you read the likes of this, you say, I'm not doing much. I can do more, I can give more time to the ilm. Whether you're teaching or whether you're studying, when you hear the likes of this, you say, I can do more, I can always do more. People who ate fish raw because of hadith that they were seeking of our Messenger sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. Al-Muradi, Abu Ishaq Al-Muradi, this narration is reported by An-Nawawi in his book Bustan Al-Arifin. He mentions from Al-Muradi, who said, جَاوَرْتُ الْحَافِظ الْمُنْدِرِي. Al-Hafiz Al-Mundiri, he said, I was his neighbor. إِثْنَتَيْ عَشَرَ سَنَى. 12 years I was his neighbor. Al-Muradi is saying, I was the neighbor of Al-Hafiz Al-Mundiri. He said, فَلَمْ أَسْتَيْقِظْ. I did not wake up. فِي لَيْلَةٍ مِنَ اللَّيَالِي. A night from the nights I didn't wake up. في ساعة من ساعات الليل. In an hour from the hours of the night. Picture this, 12 years. He says, I was his neighbor. I did not wake up a night. In any time of the night. The beginning of the night. The middle of the night. The end of the night. He says, إلا وجدت ضوء السراج في بيته وهو مشتغل بالعلم. Except I seen the light in his house on and he is busy with knowledge. حتى كان في حال الأكل والكتب عنده يشتغل فيها. Even at the time when he's eating, the books are in front of him and he's still busy with knowledge. So there was no breaks. There's no breaks. We come to the halaqah, maybe we sit, we become a bit tired, we need a drink, a snack. Look at how they were. Even the time when he's eating, the book is in front of him. And Ibn Hajar, he mentions in the tarjama, the biography of Ibn al-Qayyim in his book, Ad-Durr al-Kamina. He says he was one who had a desire, a great desire in the books and obtaining them. فَحَسَّلَ مِنْهَا مَا لَا يُحْصَى. He accumulated from books that which is uncountable. حَتَّى كَانَ أَوْلَادُهُ يَبِيعُونَ مِنْهَا بَعْدَ مَوْتِهِ دَهْرًا طَوِيلًا. Until his children and those who inherited from him, they were selling those books for many years after that. This is how much books that he accumulated. And we're talking about manuscripts. It's not how we live in this era. You want a book, you're in your house, you just buy it online and it's sent to you. We're talking about manuscripts. A person is striving to get nusakh, handwritten books. And he's gathered so many books that even after his death, his family member, they're selling those books to get food and drink. And they continue to sell for years after that. These ulama, they were people of zuhud. People who are abstinent from the dunya. And this zuhud, as the people of knowledge mentioned, the likes of Shaykh al-Islam, the correct understanding of zuhud is tark ma la yanfa' fil akhirah. Leaving off that which does not benefit you in the akhirah. This is what zuhud is. Zuhud is not to rip your clothes, say I'm not going to get married, to stay in the masjid all day. This is not from the zuhud. As you find amongst a good portion of the Sufiyyah, they have in them this extreme understanding of zuhud to the point that it leads them to fall into other sins and transgressions. And the Messenger has told us in the hadith of Anas, في الصحيحين من رغب عن سنتي فليس مني. The one who leaves off my sunnah, the one who desires other than it, he is not from me. These people were people who left off that which did not benefit in the akhirah. The Imam of Hadith al-Bukhari rahimahullah ta'ala, al-Khatibi mentions in his tariq al-Baghdad, he says Amr ibn Hafs al-Ashqar, he reports أنهم فقدوا البخاري أياما من كتابة الحديث ببصرة. They couldn't find Imam al-Bukhari for several days in the writing of hadith in Basra. They couldn't find him. قال فطلبناه فوجدناه في بيت وهو عريان. He said we began to seek him, look for al-Bukhari. We found him in the house and he was naked. Everything that he had is gone. He didn't have anything which remained with him. فاجتمعنا وجمعنا له الدراهم حتى اشترينا له ثوبا وكسوناه. He said we gathered with us some coins and we bought for him clothing in order for him to wear. And then he mentions ثم اندفع معنا في كتابة الحديث. Then he came out with us to write the hadith. This is the Imam who Allah Azza wa Jal has left for him in the dunya, Sayyidun Hasan, a beautiful mention. There's not a person who loves the hadith of the Rasul sallallahu alayhi wasallam except he says al-Bukhari rahimahullah. And this is the state he's in. Ibn Aqil rahimahullah, he mentions, who's also the scholar he quoted from previously, is from the Hanabila. He says ana uqassir bighayat juhdi awqat akli. I strive very much in lessening my times of eating. He goes on to mention that he chooses dry bread. He chooses something, rather not the dry bread, but a soft kilka'k, that which is moist from the bread, and gulping with water. He says, I choose this over eating bread because of that which is between them from madgha, just chewing. In other words, that the time period he's spending chewing, he doesn't want to waste in chewing. He prefers to be spending that time in ilm. So he takes something light which he can gulp down and go, in order for him to obtain the ilm. Look at Imam An-Nawawi rahimahullah, who we know. Ibn Attar, who is from his students, he mentions in his tarjama, his biography, fi Tuhfat al-Talibin. He mentions about his Shaykh An-Nawawi rahimahullah. He says, كَانَ رَضِيَ اللَّهُ عَنْهُ لَا يَأْكُلْ فِي الْيَوْمِ وَالْلَيْلَ إِلَّا أَكْلَ وَاحِدَةً. He would not eat in the day and night except one meal. Imam An-Nawawi rahimahullah. بعد العشاء الآخرة. After Salat al-Isha,
He would eat one meal that time. وَلَا يَشْرَبْ إِلَّا شَرْبَ وَاحِدَ عِنْدَ السَّحَرُ. And he would take one gulp or one drink at the time of the sahar, the early hours of the night before Fajr. He says, وَكَانَ لَا يَشْرَبَ الْمَاءَ الْمُبَرَّدِ. He would not drink water which is cold. And he wouldn't eat the fakiha, the fruits of Dimishq. He wouldn't eat from the fruits and he wouldn't drink, meaning he would leave off that which is of the matters which a person, his soul calls him to. And this is something, it's not lazim upon the person to leave off eating fruits. A person can eat it, but he preferred not to, so it wouldn't busy him. And we take opportunity to make dua for our brothers who are in Syria. Do not forget them in your dua. People who are being attacked unjustly by the government of the Zindiq, Al-Asad. This man, may Allah Azza wa Jal give him what he deserves. He's not a Muslim. So do not forget to make dua for them, as they are going through much difficulty, much hardship. And when a person compares even what happened in the past in Damaj, which all afflicted us in the Hisar, when you compare it to some of the incidences that have happened in Syria, you will say there's no comparison. So the people not forget our brothers and our sisters there and the difficulty and hardship they are facing. Imam Nawawi, his student Ibn Attar, rahimahullah, he's mentioning about him how he was as a person and what he used to eat and how he used to drink little and how he used to strive in obtaining the ilm. And he is who he is from the people of knowledge, who Allah Azza wa Jal, he has also given him a good mention and remembrance amongst mankind. There were those from the Salaf who their reports, when you read them about how they used to strive in writing a hadith, you become amazed how one person could write so much a hadith. Al-Khatib also reports in his Jami' Hamad ibn Salama, who rather Hamad ibn Usama, Abu Usama, is a fiqh thabt from the Rijal of the Shaykhain. He says, I wrote بيدي هذه, with this hand of mine, 100,000 hadith, 100,000 hadith. An effort in writing a hadith that likes that we're incapable of doing, many of us. And he's striving in writing these hadith. Imam al-Bukhari again, Ibn Kathir, he reports for him in al-Bidaya wa al-Nihaya. He says, وَكَانَ الْبُخَارِي يَسْتَيْقِظُ فِي اللَّيْلَةِ الْوَاحِدَ مِنْ نَوْمِهِ فَيُوقِدَ السِّرَاجِ وَيَكْتُبَ الْفَائِدَ تَمُرُّ بِخَاطِرِهِ. Imam al-Bukhari, rahimahullah, he would wake up in one night from his sleep and he would turn on the lantern and he would write a fa'idah that had passed in his mind. ثُمَّ يُطْفِي سِرَاجَهُ. Then he would turn off again that lantern. ثُمَّ يَقُومُ مَرَّةً أُخْرَى وَأُخْرَى. Then again and again, he's waking up, turning on the lantern, writing a benefit, turning it off, going back to, he's continuing in this cycle. He doesn't want this benefit which has come to him in his mind for it to pass him without him writing it. He says, حَتَّى كَانَ يُتَعَدَّدْ مِنْهُ ذَلِكَ قَرِيبًا مِنْ 20 مَرَّةً. Until it was recorded almost 20 times a night he's doing this. 20 times in one night, he's waking up, writing the benefit, going back to sleep. In our time, it is easy, and this is a benefit that you take. If you get a fa'ida, a benefit or a question which is of importance, do not let it pass you. You don't know if it will come back. So take advantage when you have that masala at that time to write it down. If you're incapable of writing, then Allah, He has given us in this era that which is of much ease, record it for yourself. You find the doctors, many of the businessmen as well, when they sit down in their majalis, they're recording what they have to say in order to preserve for themselves the dunya. So we are more deserving of preserving for ourselves the ilm. Record that benefit so that you have it with you when you're in need of it. And their hisn writing, the scholars, it was that which, so as we mentioned, some of it perplexes, some of it causes you to become amazed, dumbfounded how this can happen. Abdurrahman ibn al-Jawzi, as we mentioned previously, the author of Sayyid al-Khatir, it is mentioned in the veiled addition to Tabaqat al-Hanabila that he said when he was on the minbar, when he was on the pulpit, كَتَبْتُ بِإِسْبِعَيَّ هَتَيْن أَلْفَي مُجَلَّد. I wrote 2,000 volumes with my hands. 2,000 volumes. If you were to count the amount of books that we have here, they would go over that number. But you can visualize. You can visualize how many books he's saying I've written with my own hands. He says, وَتَابَ عَلَى يَدَيَّ 100,000. And 100,000 people repented through me. People who are upon sin, people upon transgression. 100,000 of them, they have come and made tawbah through my effort. He says, وَأَسْلَمَ عَلَى يَدَيَّ 20,000 يَهُودِ وَنَصْرَانِ 20,000 Jews and Christians, they accepted Islam through my effort. And he said this, as is mentioned, towards the end of his life. Look at the effort and look at the fruits that he left behind. 20,000 people are accepting Islam. إِخْوَانِ فِي اللَّهِ We live in a balad that the people, they are in need of our da'wah. You are a da'i. You are a caller to Allah Azza wa Jal. Either by speech or by action. You being a Muslim, your name being a Muslim name, you are, whether you like it or not, going to be calling people to Islam or distancing them from Islam. So we should strive in this while we are tested in remaining in the likes of this land. Call the people to the Tawheed of Allah Azza wa Jal. Call them to Islam. This scholar, Rahmatullah Alayhi, he's giving us something of importance for us to reflect and ponder over. The 20,000 people from the Jews and the Christians accept Islam through his hands. And this effort in obtaining ilm, it was not something which was specific to the men. Even the women, they were those who are hardworking and striving in this ilm. Those who are salihat, those who are righteous and realize the importance of knowledge, they strived in it. And we find in the Sahih from the Hadith of Abi Sa'id al-Khudri radiyallahu anhu that he said, قَالَتَ النِّسَاءُ لِلنَّبِيِّ صَلَى اللَّهُ عَلَيْهِ وَسَلَّمْ غَلَبَنَا عَلَيْكَ الرِّجَالِ That the women, they said to the Messenger صلى الله عليه وسلم that the men have overcome us towards you. They have overcome us. Meaning that they are the ones who are always around you. They are the ones who are always benefiting. We also want to benefit. They said, فَاجْعَلْ لَنَا يَوْمًا مِن نَفْسِكْ Give us a day from your life. فَوَعَدَهُنَّ يَوْمًا And the messenger gave them that day. And it is mentioned towards the end of the hadith that the messenger sallallahu alayhi wasallam told them, مَن مِنْكُنَّ إِمْرَأَةٌ تُقَدِّمُ ثَلَاثَةً مِنْ وَلَدِهَا إِلَّا كَانَ لَهَا حِجَابًا مِنَ النَّارِ That from the admonitions that he told them and reminded them with is there's not a woman, three children pass of hers, except that they are protection from the hellfire. And some of the hadith in this narration also, they said, what about two? He said, وَثْنَتَيْن, also two. And it has also been added even one in other reports. And the point that we mentioned this hadith is to show that the sahabiyat, they didn't want the messenger to be alone with the men, but they also wanted to seek the ilm that he had. To the point that they said, the men have overpowered you or overtaken you with regard to this knowledge, give us a day. And this is how the righteous woman is, trying to also obtain knowledge. Not knowing what it is from khair that will benefit her in her dunya or her akhirah. So her hunt is just like the man, trying to gather and accumulate from ilm whatsoever she's capable of accumulating and then acting upon this. Look at our mother Aisha radiallahu anha, the mother of the believers. It is mentioned about her. Hadith Ibn Hazm, he mentions that she reported 2,210 ahadith. So she is considered from the Mukthirun, from those who reported many ahadith from the Messenger. Rather, not only many, but they add her from those who reported over 1,000 ahadith from our Messenger sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. As As-Suyuti rahimahullah mentions in his Alfiyah, وَالْمُكْثِرُونَ فِي رِوَايَةِ الْأَثَرِ أَبُو هُرَيْرَةَ يَلِيهِ ابْنُ عُمَرَ Those who report multiple, countless, numerous narrations from the Messenger sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, أَبُو هُرَيْرَةَ يَلِيهِ ابْنُ عُمَرَ وأنس والبحر كالخدري and أنس and البحر the ocean who's the بحر وأنس والبحر كالخدري so we have أنس and we have أبو سعيد الخدري who is the بحر عبد الله بن عباس وجابر وزوجة النبي and جابر and the زوجة the wife of the messenger who is عائشة رضي الله عنها she's the only female that you see who's mentioned amongst them from those who reported over 1,000 hadith from our Messenger sallallahu alayhi wasallam. And she was diligent in teaching. And they used to take the ilm from her, min wara'i hijab, from behind the sitar. And she had students who took this ilm from her, radiallahu anha. And she was the most knowledgeable of the sahabiyat. And even from the men, she was those who would correct. If there was a narration which reached her from one of the sahaba, she was not held back and shy, and she would not refrain from mentioning the truth and clarifying the haqq in the mas'ala. Also from the tabi'iyat, we have the likes of Mu'adha bintu Abdullah, who died 83 years after the hijrah. She was a scholar, a faqiyah, one of knowledge, one of ibadah, الذهبي, he mentions about her, بلغنا أنها كانت تحيي الليل عبادة. She was one who used to stand up the whole night in ibadah. Ibn Ma'in rahmatullahi alayhi, Yahya ibn Ma'in, the Imam, he said about her that she was a thiqah, a trustworthy reporter. Likewise, we have from these noble women of knowledge, Amra bint Abdurrahman al-Ansariya. Amra, a scholar, thiqah, a trustworthy reporter, faqiyya. She is from those who took knowledge from the likes of Aisha radiallahu anha and Salama. And she was also declared a trustworthy reporter by Ibn Ma'in. And the list goes on. Hafsa, the daughter of Sirin, Hafsa bint Sirin. And she had with her much knowledge and was also declared trustworthy in her reports. We have Darda al-Sughra, Hujaymah, the smaller Darda, who also took knowledge from her husband and others, from the Sahaba radiallahu anhum. And it is mentioned that she died 81 years after the Hijrah. So these are reports from the women, some of them, and there are many. And there are many from the women who were people of knowledge, people who gave their lives to the ilm, and they strived in obtaining it, ikhwati fillah. And the summary of this lecture, which we summarized by, is a benefit that we take from the speech of Ibn al-Qayyim rahimahullah in Miftah Dar al-Sa'adah, when he said, وَأَمَّا سَعَادَةُ الْعِلْمِ, as for the happiness of knowledge, فَلَا يُوَرِّثُكَ إِيَّاهَا إِلَّا بَذْلُ الْوُسْعِ وَالصِّدْقُ الطَّلَبِ وَالصِّحَّةُ النِّيَّةِ. Three things that will bring to you the happiness of knowledge. Because knowledge, it has with it happiness. It has with it that which brings to the soul's delight. And you find this in the scholars, many of them, that when they find something, it is of more importance to them than gold and silver and the dunya and that which is in it. One answer in a topic which they have been looking for. So Ibn Qayyim, he says that the sa'ada, the happiness of knowledge, you will not find this illa bi, except with badlul wus'a. You give from yourself and make effort in it. وَسِدْقُ طَلَبْ, and that you're truthful in what you're seeking. Your truthfulness and your sidq ma Allah Azza wa Jal in this talab. Because from the biggest reasons a person, he falls off the knowledge and obtaining of knowledge, is that he's not truthful in it. It is a trend, it is a reason, it is something that he is doing for a purpose Allah knows, and this leads him to fall. وَسِدْقُ طَلَبْ وَسِحَّةُ النِّيَّةِ, and the siha, the correctness of your intention. So these are all reasons which lead us to obtain the sweetness of the ilm, which is the best of things that anyone could gain. As we have heard in this, that which is of benefit and a reminder for our souls, that it's not about wealth, it's not about anything but to obtain this ilm and to strive in obtaining it and to strive in implementing it. Whether you have from the dunya, whether you don't have from the dunya, this is not important. What is important is striving in this regard and going out to obtain the ilm. The maraqis, they are there. A person is capable of going and obtaining the ilm. So let us strive, ikhwani fillah. If you find in yourself that it's difficult for you to remain in this land, and it's difficult for you to obtain ilm while you're in this land, then strive in leaving it. You strive in leaving it. So we ask Allah Azza wa Jal to benefit us by what was mentioned, and to make it as a reminder for us, and that which makes us of those who strive in the knowledge and implement it. And we ask Allah Azza wa Jal to reward you as well for your patience and for your hudur, for coming out to attend. As you mentioned, it was something of great happiness to us. And we also request from the brothers, if any of them, they have a benefit or they want to remind the ikhwah, from the ikhwah who visited us, then the door is open, because there is time which still remains. نحب أن نسمع منهم. We love to hear from them. إن أحب ذلك without any إحراج. بإذن الله عز وجل we'll stop here. إخواني في الله, also as a reminder, يعني the people who are coming to the likes of this gathering, there are many in number. They're coming from different places. And we should benefit one another. If you know the halaqat are happening in the east, or they're happening in north, or they're happening in west, wherever they may be from the halaqat of khair and sunnah, then we need to work together and do ta'awun and cooperate in directing people to these majalis. as many of the people are not aware of this. If a person is incapable of portraying or propagating, then don't leave off at least the ishara. Don't leave off at least pointing others, whether it's your family members or your friends or others that you meet. Many of the people who have come to the sunnah, they came to the sunnah because of a person saying, come to a halaqa, come to a gathering. And when they came to the gathering, they benefited. So let this be of something which encourages us to direct others to the khair. بإذن الله عز وجل. سبحانك اللهم وبحمدك لا إله إلا أنت أستغفرك.